Brofist and a brofist to you all! Is the audio okay? Someone just said you sound like a fucking potato. I hope I don't. I hope I feel good. I feel fine. I feel good. Good. I look at all those hollers now streaming across the chat on the screen. Next level. And thank you so much for all those people congratulating us on having a baby. We are only 4 weeks in, so anything can happen. It's pretty normal that something might go wrong in the first 3 months. So we'll wait and see. But thank you to everybody. That's fucking amazing. It should be a good web show, because now me and Ghosty can have, like, daddy talk. That's going to be a little bit weird. But it should be fine. Me as a father. You know, I have this theory. Everything's going pretty well with the channel. Everything's going well with all the work I'm doing. People are taking really nicely to all the new videos I'm doing. And everything's looking pretty peachy for the future. And I have this theory that I will still be doing something on these lines, but bigger and larger scale in approximately 10 to 13 years' time. This is a career I'm building here, not just basing everything about World of Warcraft. As you've seen, we're mixing in lots of other stuff. Today, we even live streamed again, because Friday, tomorrow, Saturday, the day after, and Sunday, I'm going to be working extensively on the Way of the Warrior 2. Really exciting. I managed to get lots of things sort of organized and ready so that I could do that. 3 day period. It means I won't have a weekend. So I was like, when am I going to have some me time? And I don't mean to fap or anything like that. I meant some time just to do whatever the fuck I wanted. So I decided that should be today. Today I was going to do that. So we live streamed all morning, which was really cool. We leveled the Shadow Priest, we leveled the Rep Paladin, and then we played some Half-Life 2, which is awesome. So I'm getting all the games I want to play over February set up, because we're going to be leveling every character in February here on Twitch.tv. We're going to be leveling every single character to level 90. So it's going to be a bit intense. So I want to mix that up with other games. You've already seen that I've got all the Warcrafts ready. Warcraft 1, 2, and 3. I've got all the Half-Lives installed. I've got Warhammer 40k installed, ready to go. I've got Portal ready to go. All this kind of stuff. I think I'm going to get Portal 2. I'm also hoping, depending on how much we get paid this month, there's a couple of other games I want to try out, including like the Bioshocks. I've never played them. Dishonored, and Far Cry 3. A lot of you are telling me to play Far Cry 3. All these kind of games, I want to mix them in between. Every time I cap a character, I kind of want to play a different game and mix it up a little bit before I kill myself playing too much Warcraft. Can happen. I'm going to be playing a lot of different characters. So really looking forward to February. I wasn't aware how well you guys received the Transmogs 2012. Big congratulations to Augus, I believe he's in the chat right now. Augus, who took home the best transmog that we have seen out of you guys throughout all of 2012. Really big congratulations to him. And we have kind of got behind on where the transmogs are. So if you've joined us in the last couple of weeks, because the channel's growing really fast, I think we've gained something like another 1,000 or something subscribers. Let me have a quick look. Yeah, we're on 26,500 now. So we've gained about 1,000 subscribers in the last sort of month's time, which is awesome, right? That's really cool. Those of you not aware of what happens with the transmogs is a weekly competition that occurs on preachgaming.com. That's our website. Our community manager and super awesome dude, Genji, will organize and sort you guys out. Eventually, there will be weekly prizes for you guys. So if you have a transmog or you've updated your transmog, go to preachgaming.com, community contests on the forums there, and there's a big thing about all the transmog competitions we do. So weekly, it's not just once a year, we do that weekly. So you can go on there. A lot of people are starting to send them to my email again. We kind of got out of that habit. You guys almost made it, but then we gained like another 1,000 followers. And those guys want to show up and show us their transmox. Preachgaming.com, sticky screenshot on there. And it must be of your character select screen. Not in-game in some cool background that takes away from your transmog. We just want to see your transmog. It's a weekly competition. And every web show, which occurs every second Saturday with me and Ghost, we will review your transmogs and we will choose our own personal winner. It might not be the same winner who was selected by Genji, but we will pick our own personal winner and give our thoughts as well, which is pretty awesome. So that's where your transmogs go, guys, okay? Real nice and easy. Don't send them to my email. They won't get looked at if you send them to my email. I'm going to fix this because I know you guys find it annoying. There we go. This is the Alliance hoodie. Ooh, a bit of yellow. I actually started to grow on me this one. I didn't like this one at first. I wanted the Horde one really badly, the Ghosts one. I wanted that one really badly, but this one's growing on me. I actually quite like it now. Yeah, Preachy's going to be a dad. I know. I know. I'm going to be a dad. Yeah, I had this thought that in about 13 years' time, if we are at this stage already, we've got multiple systems, we've got pretty much every console there. We're missing an Xbox 360. But I think Ghost is going to give us his because he doesn't use it anymore. We've got all this stuff set up here. It's like the ultimate gamer's paradise in here. It's here for work. But the idea is, my theory on it that I tried to explain to Emma, is that I need to be in an environment where it's just all about gaming. If I'm going to produce good quality gaming content, I need to be in like a gaming zone, right? This should be the mecca of gaming. This room is built for fun. This entire room is built to have fun and have a blast. It makes life much easier when you're trying to have a blast with you guys as well. My kid gets a teenager and likes video games, which is, likely over horses, as Emma's preferring. And he brings friends home. What am I supposed to say? Motherfucker ain't allowed in this room. You will have your own shitty PC to play on, which will be of lower quality than mine. You'll also have your own shitty console, your Xbox. What will we have then? Like Xbox 1080? Some shit like that. Yeah, I will have the Xbox 1080. You will have to learn from the NES up. Okay? From the NES up. Look at Zap. My brother's like, no. 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 My child will not be thrown into the gamer's paradise that exists in 2020 or anything like that. My child must complete Mario on the NES. Then they will be provided with a SNES and a Mega Drive. And I want to see all the Sonics completed. I want to see Super Mario Bros. 3 completed, as well as Yoshi's Story. Then they will get an N64. I will not burden them with a Sega Saturn. I won't do it. That's just mean. Then they might get a Dreamcast. Then they might get a GameCube. And I want to see Wind Waker completed. And I want to see Super Mario Sunshine completed. Right? Then they can have the next system up. This is what they will go through. They will go through the trials. They will not be a wrath baby. They will not be a gaming wrath baby. They will learn. They will learn and they will adapt to the changes that we had to go through. That's right. They'll just not be thrown into the end of it. Anyway, on with today's daily. The only daily that matters. The poor kid. That poor kid, his friends are all playing Metal Gear Solid 64 or whatever. Metal Gear Solid 72. That's not how it will roll. No, they will start with Metal Gear Solid 1 and they will understand the power of the story. They will understand the power of the story. The story is what matters. The journey matters. And then my child will understand that the journey doth matter. My brother's like, not my nephew. I'm getting it straight away. My brother was the guy. My brother was the guy who forced my father to get me a Master System and a Sega Mega Drive. Still, one of the best days of my life was approaching my home to see my brother stood in the car park because we owned a pub at the time, a public house. And I looked into the rear of his car to see a Sega Mega Drive with a shoddily covered blanket. And the game that came with it, I believe, was Cool Spot. Cool Spot. Anybody remember Cool Spot? That was one of my first games. And some Donald Duck castle game. Thanks, bro. Appreciate it. So I obviously went out and moaned for Mortal Kombat for my birthday. The power of the cutscene. I want to see all the Resident Evils completed. That's what I want to see. Let's move on to some WoW news. Let's talk about WoW. Today's going to be discussing patch 5.2. I think we need to get this discussion out of the way. I think it's important. And I also want to take sort of an extended question and answer session with you guys. I think that'd be pretty cool. I haven't done many questions and answers. I do want to say one thing. The workshop is being taken and is taking such a high role right now. I'm not sure if that is like the initial wonder of the workshop, and so I don't want to overdo it. We are going to have a workshop Monday, but at the moment the workshop videos you guys are sending are phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. I would like it to take a permanent 2-day role in the daily. I think that'd be really good. So if you keep sending them, I will move it to 2 days a week. We are going to have 2 days next week. We're going to have workshop Wednesday and Monday, which I'm really looking forward to. I've got some really good videos in from you guys, so depending on that. And it's not just like an initial, oh, wow, this is great. I want to see more of that. So keep sending those in and we'll do more workshops. I know some of you are like, I've sent my workshop. When are you going to do mine? I will do everybody if it's worthwhile. If it's worthwhile. If it's not just somebody showing off, I will do everybody. So we're looking forward to that. Let's talk about patch 5.2. The news today. The big news, the big super amazing news that you're all waiting for. What is the legendary item? It's a Mater Gem. A legendary Mater Gem. Was kind of hoping for a head enchant. I know some of you were like, oh, we wanted a weapon. A legendary weapon is what I want. It's going to be a legendary Mater Gem. Now, instantly we can all see the response to that. I'm so glad I have the chat screen up right now, which is pretty crazy. Yeah, my first, I agree with Nikai. I think it's Nikai straight away. Boring. Legendary Mater Gem. Kind of like the Shard Gems. Yeah, it's an upgrade, but it's not fun, is it? It's not fun. But that's what I want, another gun. It would be nice. It would be nice. But it is going to be a legendary Mater Gem. This is kind of in keeping with the current theories on Blizzard, which is to keep things manageable. I want a little bit of unmanageability. I want that little bit of fun aspect thrown into the game. And we're going to talk about another example of where the fun has been kind of sucked out of it to make way for balancing issues and stuff like that. The Legendary Mater Gem is really easy to balance around, okay? It's really easy to balance around. End of the day, it makes their life considerably easier. It's not fucking fun. A Legendary Mater Gem is not fun. It might do something amazing. I would expect some sort of graphical association with it that can probably be turned off once all your raid has it. If it's like sparkly flowers, like you're dazed. You know when you're dazed in a game and you get all the stars and shit around and all that kind of stuff. It might have some sort of sparkly effect associated with it. But it's just going to be a relatively powerful Mater Gem. Probably with some kind of proc, I would imagine. Some sort of silly proc that goes with it. But yeah, it's not fun, is it? It's not fun. It's called the Crown of the Heavens. And, no, I read this and I was, meh. It's one of those things, it's legendary. It's got the orange attached to it. And if we look through the legendaries, does a Mater Gem compare to Thunder Fury? No. Does the Mater Gem compare to Sulfurus? No. Does it compare to Shadowmourne? No. Right? It doesn't compare even close to any of those things. It's not even close, all right? It's just going to be a more powerful Mater Gem. Why is it not just an epic Mater Gem? You know what I mean? Why is it a Mater Gem, a purple Mater Gem? I'm okay with an epic Mater Gem. Legendary Mater Gem? I'm not really cool with that. I'm not cool with it. I don't want to complain too much. An upgrade's an upgrade is an upgrade. Fine. Thunder Fury for life, brah. Good to see it's a Thunder Fury for life. It's not fun, is it? It's not fun. Especially the kind of effort you have to go through. I assume that once you unlock the Mater Gem, and you can just acquire it. I assume you can just acquire it. It would be a serious pain in the ass, and they also said that you don't have to collect the sigils again, or there is some item that drops. I'm trying to think this is going to be something like the old Zul'Gurub shoulder enchants, where you had to get an item from the boss, like Broodlord and Jindo, Mandakir and Jindo dropped these, and then you could turn them in to the shoulder enchants. So I'm kind of thinking that's what it's going to be. Is something like that. Is something in the Throne of Thunder will drop an item that you can then trade in. And you can then grab your Mater Gem from that. And therefore, after a few weeks, well, almost 25 weeks for some guilds, you'll be able to, unless two of them drop, three of them, whatever, you'll be able to turn them in and get them. So that's really what it's going to be. That's what it is. There's nothing more to it than that. It's going to be a legendary Mater Gem. A little bit disappointing. I can see the disappointment in all. As Genji just pointed out there, they created immense amounts of war. I was almost kicked from a raid once. I joined a guild run who didn't have a healer. I was the priest at the time and got invited along. They whispered me. They asked me specifically, could I go to ZG with them? They were an advanced guild, much more advanced than mine at the time. And I said to them, I don't need anything from Zul'Gurub, so not really. And he was like, oh. And then I said, well, I need a shoulder enchant. Can I get the item that gets the shoulder enchant? I asked them before I went, and they were like, yeah, sure, no problem. Can I roll on it? That's all I asked is, do I have the opportunity to roll on this item? Sure, no problem. And in we went. Lo and behold, Mandakir drops one. I roll need. I get it. And they kicked me from the raid for not trading it to one of their players. Their war broke out. Get out of the raid, you thieving priest. Who is this guildless priest who's taken our shoulder enchant? And I said, this is the only reason I agreed to come in the first place, is if I could roll on this. I told you before I joined, and that wasn't the issue. It was just somebody in the guild who knew me had invited me, wasn't the raid leader, and obviously hadn't told people that I was going to roll on it. And then he kicked me from the raid. So we can expect a little bit of war, because no doubt you've got them egotistical DPSs, or the tanks, and everybody's putting their case forward. Healers are generally going to get shit on for this, I think. I would expect healers to be a little bit shit on when it comes to legendary major gems. If you're a healer and you're up there with your legendary quest, pretty sure you're going to get shit on. Healers always tend to get the short end of the stick when it comes to this, unless they're given some kind of weapon that's specific, like the Valinir, then that's pretty cool. But in this kind of case, healers tend to get shit on quite dramatically. Even if it's a huge upgrade for your healing character, raids, and I point out, rightfully so, this is why healers tend to get shit on. It's the correct move, is it's more effective if something like that goes to a DPSer. It's then more effective sometimes to go to the tanks, because there's only two of them, they tend to have less of a war. But you might have up to 7 or 8 regular healers in your guild. They're not going to see this meta gem unless this guild is like run by a healer, I wouldn't say. It is correct that it should go to a DPSer. In terms of factual, if we cut emotion out of it and loyalty, purely factual benefit to the raid, it should go to your best DPSer. It should. It's the biggest benefit you can get. There is nothing really that benefits a raid more than the boss dying quickly. There is not. There is no greater benefit to a raid than the boss dying much faster. Therefore, your DPSers should get it. But that's not fair, is it? It's not fair. And I told, if we put emotion back into it, fuck you, man. I want my legendary as well. I've worked equally as hard from it. And in general, I don't give a shit about your DPS. I don't give a flying turd about it. The raid not dying, the raid dies less if the boss dies quicker. I see where you're coming from, Vinny. I do see where you're coming from, but the raid in general will overall survive and do better progression if the boss dies faster. That's it. It's just if the boss dies faster, you tend to have a lot less issues overall. And healing actually becomes relatively simple when the boss dies quicker, because you can spam more mana. You can just throw things around as easy. So that's what I would expect to happen here. Little bit surprised. I was expecting some sort of armory where you could choose a legendary weapon. I wasn't sure how they were going to balance it. There's definite issues there about DKs, Feral Druids, all these kind of hybrid classes, what's going to be best for them. I almost kind of thought or hoped that it would be something that could transmog, similar to Anathema or Thunderstrike and Benediction, where you could click them and they change into a different item. I think that would be pretty cool, like a DPS caster mace or sword or something like that. But that's not going to be the case, unfortunately. That's really not going to be the case. Getting back to the subject of the fun being sucked out of things, the DK, these are all your 5.2 changes pretty much. The DK DPS tier set was actually really looking like it was going to be fun. You got an extra 60 seconds, I think, or 30 seconds on your Army of the Dead, which is cool. That is a major DPS boost, and it can be timed, and it's awesome. And Army of the Dead is one of the best spells in games in the game in terms of a DPS increase. There's nothing better than you summoning an army of unfucking dead. That's really cool. You summon your own zombie army to do DPS for you. I love Army of the Dead. I think it's great. I used to time it really well on things like Ragnaros, where you could just cast this huge spell, and it felt like you were building up to this crescendo of awesome sauce. It was like, I've got a few seconds spare, and it's like, ready to go. The one I was, they changed it to its, what is it? It's now increased the chance to trigger sudden doom and killing machine. It's a fine DPS increase. It's a fine DPS increase. It's not fun. It's not that fun. It generates more resources. It generates more things. You can get your minion up quicker. You get more procs. You get more rhyme. Blah, 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 blah. It's just boring. That's the problem. It's just boring. That's my issue with it. The place, it could have an overall issue on the playstyle, I suppose. But compared to a big army of the dead, big army of the dead, I take it over for fun reasons, big army of the dead any single day. They're trying to fix Starfall again, which I think is awesome. I'm not too bothered about the changes that are occurring for PvP, so I'm going to skip over those. Changes for PvP, not really bothered. I don't think I have much an opinion or relevant opinion on those in any way. I will want to point out the Wild Mushroom change for the Resto Druids. They're nerfing Resto Druid healing across the board. I haven't really seen how much they're going to do that, but they are just flat out nerfing Resto Druid healing across the board, which is pretty interesting. That's pretty interesting. But the new Wild Mushroom is going to confuse a lot of players. They're going to see various benefits of it. I'll just read it to you. Wild Mushroom will now gain 75% of the overhealing performed by Druid's Rejuve, up to a maximum of 100% of the Druid's health in bonus healing, and growing larger as they do so. When Bloom is cast, the bonus healing will be divided evenly amongst the targets in the area of effect. It's actually a great solution to Wild Mushroom for two reasons. We have talked about this a little bit in the past, but it does allow that benefit of, in major AoE situations, you're not going to see as much overhealing on Rejuve as you will if you're just kind of spamming it and waiting for that big, big burst damage, which is what the Wild Mushrooms are for. We should point this out. The Wild Mushroom healing is for that big burst AoE damage. So you take that big burst and then boom, good Resto Druids are going to mushroom the shit out of it. So we're going to see a nice advanced playstyle from the Resto Druids, which you should start getting used to, is if you know, let's say Titan Gas on the Emperors. Titan Gas is a good example, a very heavy healing phase. Nice burst healing will do there. Not a great deal of AoE damage going on in the meantime. A good Resto Druid is now going to be firing off just a few Rejuves in the meantime to start boosting those mushrooms up, because they know that big heavy hitter is coming. And then when they do, they're going to get a really nice Wild Mushroom out of it. Instead of sort of, should I do some spot healing, some healing touches here and there, they're going to wait for these big moments. When it comes to consistent charged AoE damage, there's not going to be a lot of AoE overhealing from Rejuve. Rejuve's actually going to be doing its full potential. Therefore, the Wild Mushrooms are going to be reasonably balanced. The issue that could have arisen if they did it a different way, such as flat out buffing Wild Mushrooms, is that Druids would just use Wild Mushrooms. They didn't want that. They'd just be like, mushroom, 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 bloom. Mushroom, 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 bloom. And just keep firing these off consistently. And then all the complaints of, will you stack constantly so I can make the best use of my mushrooms, all that kind of stuff. And it just becomes a really boring and not much thought and skillless ability. This one, I really like what they've done here. So if you're playing a Resto Druid, get used to this style of play. This little bit of pre-planning that goes into your head. We will be doing a Resto Druid workshop on Monday. I want you to point that out. We will be doing a Resto Druid workshop on Monday, so you can kind of see some tips coming out from that. And this mushroom effect, really like how balanced this is. I think this is really clever. Really, really clever. I want to talk about little magey bits. Frosty's being buffed. This is cool. I think Frost is possibly even more fun than Fire. Fire is fun because not only is it simple, but when all the procs go off and stuff like that, you're just in heaven, right? Fire has the ability to really make the class the most fun thing in the universe. Fire has that ability to just make you just like, oh, this is a brilliant class. And it was a good feeling. It's not quite got that at the moment, especially if you're in mid to low gear. My mage is level 90, but he's only got a couple of pieces of LFR gear. Fire's not as appropriate. It does decent damage, but it still suffers a little bit from the RNG in that lower gear level. To give you an example, on the Stone Guard, on the LFR I did this week, I was filming something that I'm not going to show you yet, but I won't tell you what it is. But I was filming something. And on the Stone Guard, my Fire Mage, I hadn't played Fire yet on my Mage. I decided to play Fire. I did 105k DPS on my Blue-Geared Mage. My Blue-Geared Mage with a couple of LFR items, I did a consistent 105k DPS on the Stone Guard. I was a little bit lucky, but I didn't realize it. I got lots of crits, I got some good pyros, some really nice combustions, and generally I was way ahead at number one of the DPS, and I had a great time doing it as well. I was like, this is Fire. This is Fire. This is what brought me to Fire. This is why Fire is amazing, because I can just fucking burn the things to the ground. I am literally incinerating this boss. And I love that. I think that's amazing. The next boss, I forget his name, you know the one, runs around with the fucking shield and all that, the wildfire spark that nobody seems to know they have on them, even though their character goes, wildfire spark on me, bro! And they fucking stand next to you, that boss. we're doing the Defeng. So you're doing Feng. You know the guys, right? Feng. Feng LFR is just comedy. Arcane Resonance on me. And they stand in the middle of the raid just AoEing the shit out of everybody. It's the most graphically intensive debuff I've ever seen. You compare it to the bomb at Vale, you barely knew you had it. Unless you had a boss mod and really paid attention to your debuffs, you didn't really know that you had the bomb. You got some increased DPS. People are like, oh, this is pretty cool. what, Baron Geddon's bomb? A little bit of a graphic thing. In Feng, Arcane Resonance literally makes your character Arcane explode every half fucking second. People still don't notice they have it. Absolutely baffling. But on Feng, I did not crit once on my Fire Mage until the boss was at 72%. That was a bizarre situation to be in. I did not crit once, a single time on my Fire Mage, he was reforged and buffed correctly, until the boss was at 72%. Which means I was just in downtown fucking failboat town. I was absolutely depressed. So, so depressed. I think I was averaging something like 40k DPS at that point. Absolutely atrocious. Not a single crit until then. And that's the fucking fail of that. I did get some crits mid-session. I managed to pull myself back up to third in the DPS. But to sit there with like combustion, just chilling, trying to force a fucking crit and all that kind of stuff, it just wasn't fun. Frost is consistent. Frost is really consistent, and it's hella fun as well. It also has a nice little bit of thinking involved with it, especially when you're planning where your freeze should land, abusing freeze on different targets to get better Fingers of Frost. So they're going to buff Frost, which I think is really cool. The Fingers of Frost is going to have an extra 3% chance to activate, which is really cool. And Frozen Orb's getting an extra 1%, which is really cool. And Blizzard's getting some as well. And Glyph of Ice Lance now causes Ice Lance to deal 50% damage to one additional target, was 40. So they're buffing the cleave from Frost as well. They believe that's enough to bring Frost up into the ranks. Frost is already kind of there. It's a little bit behind. But Frost is so much fun and so, so consistent. That's what I like about Frost. So, so consistent and fun at the same time. A nice medium between Arcane, which is just extremely consistent. Arcane is just stupidly consistent to the point of being dull. And Fire is really inconsistent, but with moments of absolute glorious fun. Frost is in a nice place in between, so I'm looking forward to that and trying out some Frost myself. The Windwalker ability, we talked about this. Windwalker's getting changed a little bit. They're gaining the new ability, which is kind of the cleave ability. It's not working on the PTR right now. I tried it out. It generally makes you unhittable, which is kind of retarded. If you try and do any of the arena on the PTR, you're going to have a bad time. It's full of Windwalkers who can't be damaged just using this ability. I might be fixed now. I'll try it again later, but it's a little bit crazy. So they're getting the new cleave. Not too bothered about that. Tiger Eyes Brew now gains one charge after spending 3 chi was 4 chi. They're going to allow you to get this up quickly. Windwalkers always suffered a little bit from their lack of burst, which is a shame. It's what I spoke about in the guide, the lack of burst ability. They kind of think maybe this is going to solve that problem. We tend to Bloodlust very early in the fight. That's kind of annoying for Windwalkers who need to get up their Tiger Eye Brew. If you've played a Windwalker, it's kind of that situation where you just, you know, I just want to be there and get that situation sorted and be powerful with my monk. And it's not quite there because your Tiger Eye Brew is a major DPS cooldown. So I'm really looking forward to see if that just fixes that issue. If we can get up to there really quickly, spending 30 chi isn't going to take you that long. It's not going to spend you that long to get that 30 chi. So I'm pretty cool on that. I think Priest is the big one. Priest is the big one. You know, I didn't do a Dis Priest guide yet. I'm going to do one for a number of reasons. One, Dis was incredibly broken when I did the Priest guides. It was just pointless to play. It was atrocious. You were instantly. It didn't really work. Then they kind of buffed it a little bit, but in doing so, made the playstyle really, really boring. At the same time, Shadow Priests were kind of dominant in Arena for the wrong reasons. When I say dominant, I'm not saying they were everywhere, but they kind of had this ability to one-shot you if everything went well, especially with the way Devouring Plague worked. It didn't take a great deal of skill to play a Shadow Priest, particularly. It was pretty simple to do. There wasn't much to manage, just a few procs. And you basically, like we saw in the workshop, is the decision-making process kind of came down to how you should AoE. Even on a general level, the actual DPS side of it wasn't amazing. In fact, the most difficult part of it was moving 30 yards away for your Halo to get the most out of it. They're going to change loads of things with the Priest to try and fix a lot of these problems. We've now got a new way Mind Flay is going to work, okay? If you have 3 damage over time spells on your target, so you've got Devouring Plague, Vampiric Touch, and Shadow Word Pain, Insanity is now going to cause Mind Flay to deal double damage for the duration. That is a really nice little rework to put in. It means you need to time your Devouring Plague a little bit better. Because once you have these three things on, your natural instinct is just to Mind Blast and do so on and so forth. There's going to be some interesting discussion there as to whether or not it's going to be worthwhile actually just dropping Mind Blast for the duration of that Devouring Plague and getting that super ability in there. It's a talent, but it adds a nice little class of play. I want to see how that works out. I think that's pretty cool. Devouring Plague's now gone back to not being bursty. Nice even spread of damage. This could kill Shadow Priest in arena. So all I'm a little bit worried about is Shadow Priest were reliant on 3-orbing, instant mind blasting some people. From what I've seen, Shadow Priest are kind of reliant on that. But they were generally playing Immortal. Is it God Cleave? Something like that, God Cleave, where they essentially just cannot die. They're basically two healers. So Flash Heal has been reduced for the Shadow Priest, so they can't heal, which I think is pretty cool. The discipline changes. This is the interesting one. This is the interesting one. Penance, damage, and healing has been increased by 20%. People were, in fact, dropping Penance from their rotation as Disc Priest. They were just so reliant on Spirit Shell. And Spirit Shell and Prayer of Healing were doing so much that they were almost dropping Penance from there, which is a key ability of the Disciplined Priest, which was really sad to see. Really sad to see people doing that. So they're going to buff that to give people the ability to press more than just a couple of buttons. Having your own class with 30 spells being reduced to 3 or 4 is really sad state of affairs. It's not fun. It's not interesting. It doesn't matter if you're topping the healing meters, which Disciplined Priests were and are to this day. If you're only using a couple of spells, it's still boring. Still really fucking boring. They altered Rapture for the mana gain. Divine Aegis is no longer guaranteed when Prayer of Healing is cast. This is again trying to move people away from just using a couple of spells. If you don't know what Divine Aegis is, it's when you heal, you gain and absorb as a Disc Priest on that person. The effect now only procs when the spell crits. Just trying to get you to use more spells. Which I'm kind of okay with. I'm kind of okay with these changes. It's just pushing you to say, don't just use these two fucking spells. I'm just really happy that they're starting to say, use this, try and mix it in, I should say. Rogues gaining a fucking actual raid utility. How about this? Rogues gaining an actual suitable raid utility. Smoke Bomb will now reduce the damage taken by allies in the area of effect by 20%. That is a major raid cooldown. That is an immense raid cooldown. I think that is insane. Absolutely insane. I read that and I was like, good for you. But do we need more raid cooldowns? I guess so. Smoke Bomb now reduces damage taken by allies. I actually see this as a buff to 10 men. 10 man guilds who sometimes lack those big major raid cooldowns, such as 20% reduced damage is fucking amazing. That is amazing. Absolutely amazing. Sure, it has its place in arena, but for me, it's more about raiding, as you know. This gives a lot of options to guilds now for how to reduce damage. I'm kind of worried that maybe we'll move into the idea of having a lot more big things that need a cooldown. 20% is immense. Absolutely fucking immense. I think that is absolutely crazy. But you guys seem happy about it. So we've got yet another major raid cooldown, and it's going to the rogues. Did rogues need this? I kind of think they did. Rogues kind of fell into the spot of not bringing anything in comparison to everybody else, but we're now getting back into the homogenization of classes where everybody's bringing something important. Everybody has something. Kind of negates the fun of it. You might as well just give everybody bloodlust, pretty much, as long as everybody has access to it. But yeah. I kind of think rogues needed something. Am I happy it's a 20% raid damage reduction? I'm sure the rogues are. I would like to have seen a damage increase, actually. Something along the lines of Stormlash Totem. I would maybe have preferred that. I would maybe have preferred something that actually increases damage. I think increasing damage is way more fun than reducing damage. There's so many things in the game right now that reduce damage. We have tons and tons of them. Boosting damage, AoE raid-wide, not so much. So I would like, yeah, some sort of crit increase, something like a Skull Banner. I don't think that would have worked. Skull Banner's crit damage increase, actually. So, crit increase. I don't know how I would have worked it to make sense. Smoke Bomb reducing 20% damage actually makes total logical sense. It's harder to find people in the smoke. They taste less damage. I think rogues are so DPS focused, though, I'd like to have seen something that buffed the raid damage in some fashion. I think that would have been more fitting. But smoke bombs certainly makes sense, and it's good to see that the rogues will have something, so I'm quite okay with that. Those of you who've been complaining constantly in the chat about your elemental shamans, do not worry, you're getting buffed. Do not worry, you are getting some nice boofs. You're getting buffed. The one that bothers me, chain lightning will now deal the same damage to subsequent targets as it does to the first. Has anybody ever seen a shaman struggle with chain lightning? Ever? Or not realize that chain lightning is really, really powerful on its own? Chain lightning is not something I thought needed a fix, right? Okay, everyone. Yes, yes, yes. La, la, la. Okay, so we can see who plays an elemental shaman and who doesn't. We can see that quite clearly in the chat right now. Who does that? Of all the problems I thought shaman has, I didn't think it revolved around chain lightning. I did not think that was the case. I never thought, you know what they need to fix? Chain lightning. It's not doing enough damage. I was hoping for a lot more single target damage, not just, yeah, as someone says, we don't need help with cleave. We don't really need that. But Smeagol Baggins is worse than Dildo Baggins. Yeah, as Cicero just says, I don't understand why they would fix that of all things. How about a single target fix? I totally agree. I've seen shamans. I always felt bad for some elemental shamans. The best one I ever knew was Katsumi. He's a really, really nice guy in Method. When he could cleave, his damage was off the fucking chain. He was off the hook. He would chain lightning the crap out of things and do mad damage. Game single target and it was like, lower down. It wasn't as fun. You give him something to cleave, he was all right. Elemental Mastery has been buffed, and that's it. Lava Beam's damage now increases with jumps. Each jump increases its damage to 10%. Again, another cleave buff. The only single target change is a slight rework of Elemental Mastery. I don't think that's the changes that shamans were hoping for. I really don't think so. I really don't think that was the changes shamans were hoping for to get higher on the killing the boss meters. I don't know. It seems to be one of the things that didn't need fixing, so we're going to fix it, you know? It's not quite what the issue is. That is the only single buff, is the Talent Elemental Mastery is now 90 second cooldown. It was 2 minutes, so we'll see. He's still capable of incredible burst, obviously, but yeah, a little bit worried. Maybe they're worried about Arena and it becoming the case of elemental shamans who were dominant around about TBC, I want to say. Harry Potter Cleave, the Burning Crusade, I believe it was Harry Potter Cleave. Elemental Shaman... Mage something? Warlock something? Mage Warlock something? Something like that. Warlocks. Okay, so they finally caved on the Warlocks. Warlocks are getting another 10% damage reduction with Fel Armor. I don't think they needed that. Blood Pact has been removed. This is a sad day. If you've known Warlocks since vanilla, Blood Pact being removed is a sad, sad day. It's a sad day. Blood Pact is like the first thing that you get about level 2. When you get, I think you get the imp at level 2. And Blood Pact was there. And it was awesome. And Blood Pact is one of those things that old school players are going to be sad to see disappear. Blood Pact is classic. Real classic. But we have to move on with the time, so we'll move on. So now your Dark Intent now increases stamina in addition to spell power. They've just removed the Blood Pact entirely. This is purely because... They didn't want Warlocks to be forced to use their imps in 10-mans. 10-mans, yet again, fucking shit up. Fuck 10-man. 10-man cost us Blood Pact, right? 10-man cost us blood Pact, which is really, really sad. Really, really sad to see that go. So your Dark Intent now just increases stamina in addition to spell power. I'm kind of waiting for the day when you can just turn on all raid buffs. And take these away. I think it's just getting a little bit boring now to even have these raid buffs. It's just getting a little bit tiresome that they have to rebalance so much around them. I'd rather either we don't have raid buffs at all. This is the thing, right? Being in a raid, you should feel more powerful than you are on your own. You should be able to do more damage. You should be able to do more things being in a raid. Which I agree with. But baking them all in so you cannot possibly be without those buffs with just a couple of classes. I mean, I think you could pretty much cover nearly all raid buffs with like a hunter, a warlock and something else, you could pretty much cover like 9 out of 10 fucking, or is it 8? 7 out of 8 raid buffs just with 3 classes. I think you could cover near enough everything, which is a little bit shoddy to me. It's just not that fun. It's not that fun. And the other one that interesting, it's not even a buff or a nerf or anything like that. It was just that Demonology Chaos Wave has a new visual. Why? I liked the Chaos Wave visual. I thought the Chaos Wave visual looked cool. Unless it's going to be cooler. I hope they don't change it. Does anybody remember the original Earthquake graphic? Anybody remember that for Shamans? The original Earthquake graphic was awesome. It was really, really cool. And then they changed it. Now it sucks. It sucks. I can't remember. I could be wrong, actually. I could be wrong. Was the original one where the ground cracked and it looked awfully brown? Or is that the one now? Yeah, I could be wrong. The original one either sucked or was good. The one that looked like the fake brown thing that was all cracked and shit, that looked terrible. The floor cracking and smashing everywhere. Yeah, that was terrible. Okay, I totally disagree. The new Earthquake is better. The original one was terrible. It was fucking really bad. I haven't seen a Shaman cast Earthquake in so long that I can't remember what the current graphic is for it. But yeah, the original one was terrible. The original one was really bad. Even if you had a blue floor, you have this brown cracking floor. It's terrible. It was really bad. So yeah, I agree with that. But I still think Chaos Wave looks cool. I still think Chaos Wave looks cool, so I'm not too bothered about that. Warriors. I hate reading any warrior changes. I do, because it's never good. There's one good one. Bladestorm can no longer be disarmed. When that was brought into the game, I was so angry that Bladestorm could be disarmed. Because nobody would ever disarm a warrior unless they were Bladestorming. No one would ever fucking do that. As soon as you Bladestormed, you were disarmed. It was just retarded. Bladestorm is amazing, right? Bladestorm is fucking so, so good. And then you could be disarmed. How do you disarm me? I'm spinning in a ball of death. Are you telling me you stuck your arm into the ball of death to take away my weapon? Is that what's going on here? Because your arm should be chopped off if you're trying to do that. You should be able to disarm a Bladestorming warrior, but unable to hold a weapon for the remainder of the game. That would be a necessary debuff. If you really want to disarm a Bladestorming warrior, you should literally have to drop your weapon for the remainder of the arena game. I'm fucking serious. I really think that's what should happen. Defensive stance being nerfed. Tanks apparently too powerful. Defensive stance is being nerfed for other warriors, and Wavering Sentinel now improves the damage reduction defensive stance. So prop warriors are staying the same. I misread that. Prop warriors are staying the same, but defensive stance will now suck for Fury and Arms warriors. So it's not nerfed. That's fine. That's fine. Second Wind will no longer regenerate health while the warrior is stunned. PvP change. Warbringer now reduces the target's movement by 50% for 15 seconds in addition to its other effects. Don't like passive slows. Don't like passive slows. I understand it's for PvP. I basically stopped hamstringing people in my first BG. It was just a waste of time. Everybody could get out of it. Okay, the arms, the actual PvE changes. Taste for Blood has been redesigned. It now causes the warrior to gain 2 stacks of overpower. Maximum of 5 stacks when Mortal Strike deals damage. 1 stack when the target dodges and no longer interacts with Heroic Strike. I've never been more depressed. What was the problem? Was Taste of Blood too fun? Was that the issue? What was it? Because it gave us something to watch? Huh? What was the... Taste for Blood. When you Mortal Strike, you will now get a... 2 stack of overpower up to a maximum of 5. 1 stack if the target dodges. So fucking boring. Overpower now costs 10 rage. That's great. That's really cool. Thank you, PvP. Thank you, PvP. Thank you, PvP, for taking all our fun away. We appreciate it. Thank you very much. Fury, blood surge now reduces the... overpower now costs rage. To use all your overpower stacks, you need 50 rage. You need 50 fucking rage to use all your overpower stacks. 50 rage. That's not easy. So you're just going to be pressing Mortal Strike and overpower. Pretty much. And you know what the stupid thing is? Next patch, Slam will get buffed, and you won't even need to fucking Overpower anymore. Overpower will be like a waste of time. Slam will be buffed, do well more damage than Overpower. You're not going to use Heroic Strike anymore, are you? You're really just not going to use it. 50 Rage, 5 Global Cooldowns. Alright, whatever. Those are your basic changes. I've missed a couple of classes out because there's nothing much happening to you. Rolling a Shadow Priest anyway, yeah. You all know about the Blade Flurry change for the Combat Rogues. We talked about it in the web show. It's just going to be, it's more of an AoE thing. But yeah, those are the major changes. Those are the major changes. I kind of wanted to go over those. I was more interested in the Legendary Mater Gem, a bit boring. And the rest of the stuff. It's kind of okay. The biggest changes I'm impressed with are the Wild Mushrooms for the Resto Druids. I think that adds some thinking and some class to it. And really gives some opportunity for Restoration Druids to perform really well when played correctly. I love that. I like there being a slightly larger gap in people who are pre-planning things rather than not. And the changes to Frost. Really looking forward to that. I think that's really cool. I'm interested to see what comes from the Dis Priest. I'm looking forward to... I'm going to do the Dis Priest guide in 5.2. There's so many changes, it's pointless me doing a Dis Priest guide until 5.2 because it's going to be instantly out of date. Therefore, I will do the Dis Priest guide in 5.2. I'm kind of looking forward to doing it. I hope these changes work really well. I think that could be pretty sweet. That could be pretty sweet. Well, let's see what happens with the Shamans. Everything else is Warriors, man. Nothing is making me want to play my Warrior right now. Nothing. One interesting side note is that Heroic Pandaren Dungeons will now give you 100 Justice Points per boss. Which is nice. Justice Points were kind of not easy to come by. They could do with, I hope they release some new Justice Points gear to go along with that. The Justice Points gear is, I believe I'm correct in saying this, is lower than the actual 463 items or 469 or whatever they are that drop in Heroics, 467. The 100 Justice Points, the Justice Points gear was like 450 or something like that, or 454, 458, 458, yeah, 458. So that really doesn't make sense. You can only get them in Heroic Dungeons. So why does it award you lower level gear? What was the thinking behind that? Yeah, Heroics are 463, Justice Points is 458. I mean, I literally, the only thing I bought on my Mage with Justice Points, because I got to 2k, I think, I got to like 2.5k. The only thing I bought was a trinket because one hadn't dropped, just to get the item level to get into LFR, which is pretty awesome. So less badge gear is a good thing. I disagree. Badge gear exists for a reason. Badge gear exists for a good reason, is that it counteracts the shitty item drops. Justice Point gear is for people who are leveling, right? You're not going to get raid quality gear from Justice Points, or, well, eventually in the expansion we might do. But the whole idea of Justice Points is actually a really good thing. Because there are certain items that just refuse to drop. They just do not drop. Your luck just lets you out. And it's gear that's like really loser gear. You know what I mean? It's like blue heroic cape. Are we particularly arsed that someone can get one from Justice Points? It should at least be the same item level as the content that you do to achieve those Justice Points. That makes sense. That's the whole point badge gear exists. It's pretty cool. It's Brad gear. It's just to fill out the items. If you're like, let's say your game on your alt. Let's say you're playing on your alt, right? And you just want to do LFR on him a couple of times a week. And that's it. He's just an alt character. You're not going to farm the reputations on him. You're just going to do LFR a couple of times a week. And you can't really enter that LFR because a cape or a trinket has never dropped for you. Do you know what I mean? It's just not dropped. That's why Justice Point comes in. It's not like you haven't farmed for it or haven't done your quest for it or anything. Or, well, maybe you haven't done your dailies for it. But those kind of things. Just fill out, they just pad out those silly drops that just don't occur. You guys have all been there when something you wanted hasn't dropped. And it's annoying. It's annoying as fuck. I have no problem with badge gear for that stuff. Who cares about someone getting some badge item to get into LFR? Who gives a shit? Who gives a shit, really? Is it bothering you that much? I don't think it's an issue. Okay, we're going to take some questions. Let me find the first question. Yeah, it was a question that came in via my YouTube inbox, which I very rarely check. I just want to point it out, if you really want to get hold of me, preachgaming@gmail.com is the best. About once a month, I will check the personal messages sent to me on YouTube. When they start filling up and I start seeing like 50 or 60, that's when I'm going to check them, just to see what's on there. Mostly, where's my UI? It's on my website. It really is. It's on my website. There's a video on my channel. It's really hard not to find it. I'll put it below as well, on the Twitch page, but that's going away anyway, so we'll see what happens with that. Okay. I'll take questions in a sec. Well, this one is looking for guilds. How do I find... The general crux of the question is, how do I find guilds on other realms? I want to join a raiding guild. How do I go about finding one? It's really, really quite easy, okay? So I'm just going to bring this up here so I can show you. Okay. Can we go to here? Yeah, yeah. This website is what you need, okay? It's wildprogress.com. Wildprogress.com is what you need. I'll just move that over there. Wildprogress.com. Go to wildprogress.com, and literally all you do is you type in a realm. So if you're not sure what's on your server, so if I was to say Sylvanas, I don't know what the raid situation is on Sylvanas. I really don't know what it is. I don't know. I don't care. That kind of thing. It's not something I've ever had to deal with. So if I go to Sylvanas, EU Sylvanas, type in your server and go. And we're looking for guild progress. Okay, those are the guilds on our server. Some enraged scrubs with some crappy main tank. And now you can see, these are actually more guilds than you probably even realized were raiding on your server. And you can see their progress straight away, okay? Which is pretty, pretty good. It's pretty awesome. So you can see, if you were Alliance here, you might be... I have no idea. And you start looking... good shout, Amon. So you can see these guys here, and you can start just flicking through them. A lot of people seem to think that if they leave their guild, let's go back on. Let's say you are in, where the hell is, let's say you're in Ravens, right? You're in the Ravens. You're doing okay. You're doing all right. Oh, they're Stark. All right, let's say you're in Stark Industries. You're doing all right. You're doing some Toast of the Endless Spring, but you're kind of ready to move on. Remember, Stark... I mean, let's be impressed here by Stark Industries. Stark Industries is not a raid guild. They just raid, like, once or twice a week with whoever's basically on. They've got a little team together. They're out-progressing so many people. So be impressed, Stark. You're actually out-progressing so many people. A lot of these people are probably really trying to raid. Okay? Really trying to raid. So, Stark Industries. But you're ready to move on. You're ready to look for a bigger and better guild, which is cool. So you can actually start flicking through. So your Horde, you're on Sylvanas. Every single person else. Now, you might go Legacy of Kings. Well, they're 1 out of 6 heroic. They've not quite finished yet. So I don't fancy that. But Sarabi, Finn is probably, it might be a finish only guild. I don't know. Blood Logic. And then you can see here who's recruiting. So let's say Blood Logic. They're 2 out of 6 heroic. Slightly ahead. You've got Synchron here, 3 out of 6. Synchron are 42. No way. They used to be quite cool. And then you can start moving up. Maybe you want to look at... you want to move to 25 man. So you've got Trial and Error, 25 man, and they are recruiting. So let's click Trial and Error. They've killed Alagon, not bad. And they're looking for Death Knights, Druid, Monks, Priests, Rogues, Shamans, and Warlocks. They've got a high requirement for Warlocks. They're a friendly, non-hardcore, 25 man guild. We've been around for 6 years, and I can guarantee that. I remember them when they were around. And they just require high attendance. They raid 4 days a week. It's as simple as that. A lot of people don't realize how many guilds are raiding on their server. They really do not realize how many there is. There are loads. I've never heard of any of these guilds. I've never heard of Crooks and Liars, is pro. I've heard of those. Kill Guides, no idea. The Ambassadors of Pain. Stark, you're being killed by the guild. You're being beat by the guild, the Ambassadors of Pain. Okay? The Ambassadors of Pain. Who are the Ambassadors of Pain? Do I recognize anybody in this guild? But they're recruiting. The Ambassadors of Pain. The guild name doesn't always matter. The guild name doesn't always matter. But there you can see. So if this was me, and I was looking for a 25-man raid guild, and I was Horde on Sylvanas, Infinite are apparently 10 and 25, which I find kind of interesting. 10 and 25. But they're looking, look at all these people. They're looking for loads of people. They raid 5 times a week. Semi-hardcore 25 man. And you can kind of get the idea of what they are. They're quite dedicated. Maybe you're not ready for that if you're coming from a guild like Stark, where you've just kind of got your raiding wings, so to speak. You got used to being in raiding. I think my opportunity would be something like Trial and Error. If I was getting back, if I was up from a guild that was doing normals and looking for some heroics, I would kind of start looking around this area. Perhaps you're not going to get in. Perhaps you're not one of those classes. That's okay. But if I'm looking for 25 mans, I've got options there. You can invite, ask in Rage Revolution. They'll just accept anybody. They will. It's unbelievable, really. Just send an invite and you're in, pretty much. But you've got plenty of choices there. And if anything, if you want to stay on the server, loads of Alliance guilds as well. This is really your first start. This is the first place you want to start looking, okay? Go on WoW Progress. Check out the exact condition of your server. Really, I recommend that entirely. I think it's a great place to start. Any questions from anyone in the audience? While you're on topic, me and my two friends are looking for a 25-man raid team since we're getting a bit tired of 10-man raiding after two expansions of it. We would like to play in the same guild, but guilds aren't keen to accepting a 3-man team. Do you have any suggestions? Well, what server are you on? For a start, answer me that. Gutalung, what server are you on? There's an open slot in Team 2 on Stark as well, looking for a healer with a DPS spec. So if you are on Sylvanas and Horde, give them a shout out. You're on Magtheridan EU. Okay, so let's have a quick look, shall we? See what's going on there. I know this isn't the main crux of it, but we can see is there opportunity for you on Magtheridan? Magtheridan EU. Are you Horde or Alliance? You're planning on... Oh, you want to move. Do you want to move because you don't think there's anywhere to go, or what? Yeah. Well, bloody hell. Lots of allies. Not many guilds, though. Not many guilds. Reasonable progress across the lot, though. But 10-10. This is the problem. Look at that. 10-10-10-10-10. 10-10. Oh, I'm on Sylvanas. This is not Magtheridan. This is not my back makeup. 10-10-10-10-10-10-10. Yeah, do you think there's a problem with 25-man guilds? I do. 10-10-10. Oh, well, this is why you have to move. Oh, shit. There is no raiding guilds on Magtheridan. Oh, my God. No wonder you want to move. No wonder you want to move. That is atrocious. There are literally 36 guilds with any... And these are only 1 out of 6s as well. Wow. Okay, so we can kind of see why you want to move. we can definitely see why you want to move. Okay, one way to start is to do this. If you're not sure what I just did, go on Realms, go on EU. if you're English, choose English. And then you can kind of see the realm populations and their balance, okay? So at the minute, Burning Legion is in good shape. And you can see here things like average times for Wintergrasp, not that much good in Tol Barad, but it still gives you a good idea. This is where I would start. Yeah, there's no players on Magtheridan EU, I completely agree. Sylvanas rocking in at number 12. Fuck yeah, go Sylvanas. Oh, look at the Horde to Ally ratio. 1 to 0.4. Terrible. Look at this one. Twisting Nether. No wonder a method went Horde at Twisting Nether. Look at that. 1 to 0 Alliance. 1 to 0. Look at that. 1 to 0. That's really sad. But I would start looking at places like this. Your ally, so you want a decent ally server. So Grim Batol is good. Sylvanas is good. So Sylvanas is actually really good. You can see here. You've also got Ravencrest is good. Look for it where there's a higher alliance population than Horde. Great place to start, okay, Gutalang. Look for somewhere where there's good population of alliance. So Alkandown is good. Burning Legion is really good right now. Burning Legion is one of the places to be. So if you look at Burning Legion, 10-10-10-10-10. Not many good 25. Oh, okay, you got Mallory Seed recruiting. And they're looking for quite a few players there. So this is how I would do it, Gutalang. Simple as this, all right? I would go on WoW Progress. If you're not sure what I did there, I just went on Realms, EU, and then selected English. And just flick through here and just look through what's going on. So Realms, EU, English. And then just look for a nice, if you want to stay Alliance, look for a nice Alliance population, like Grim Batol. Looking pretty good. Wow, look at the Alliance domination there. Look at the Alliance domination. And then find a guild that's in the place for you. How to persuade people is just in the name of your application, that you're three friends who wants to play together. Everybody's going to be wary. There's nothing I can tell you that's going to make that better. There's nothing I can tell you that's going to make that better because it's not better. You're the ones who need to do the convincing. I would say something like, we are all aware that we are friends, but we don't have much issue playing a part. Because that's the problem. If one of you leaves, all of you are going to leave. No guild wants to tie themselves to that. And you can understand why. You're going to have to do your best to really work at that. You're going to have to convince them. And you might have to lie. Nothing wrong with lying in your application about some things. But you need to be aware why. You know why guilds are afraid of it. And rightfully so. One person leaves, one person gets punished, you cause a problem, you'll be out. Simple as that. And that leaves them three players down instead of one. So you need to accept that among your three friends. If you want to do it, take your time and do it. And it's possible. It is possible sometimes. Now, this might work, and you could try this on a variety of different guilds, okay? There's obviously a lot of guilds to choose from. Try this. Let's say this could work. Dimensional. You wanted to move to this guild, Grimbatol, Dimensional. So we click on Dimensional. Dimensional's looking for all those, okay? Apply individually and not at the same time. Not at the same time, in the same minute. Apply individually. See if three of you get a trial. Try and keep it secret that you're real life friends for a while. It's fine. You can do that. And there's plenty of guilds to do it to. I mean, that was just something I found in 6 seconds. So you could try Dimensional, try Got Issues, all that kind of thing. Try all these different ways and you should be all right. It should be pretty cool. All right? You can give it a go. See what happens. Okay. Any other questions? Question. Or more of a request. When doing class guides, can you do a new section be added for buffs, spells essential to track with Tell Me When? I'll see. I'm not promising anything with that. Everybody has their own personal preferences with Tell Me When. Everyone has their own personal preferences. Da-da-da-da. Any other questions before I go? I don't have any more alts. Preach, why do you think it's seldom seeing ungem people in dungeons? It was very common in Kata because gems are stupidly cheap now. I was surprised how cheap they are. The best gems for my mage were like 20 gold each. That's the only reason. They're just so cheap, it's just idiotic not to do it. If things are really cheap, people are going to do it. Simple as that. No problem at all. So it was so, so cheap. Any other questions? Can I look up Deathwing EU? All right, preach. Thank you for your donation, my friend. Graham, thank you very much. Again, if you do wish to support the channel and donate, button's below. But thank you very, very much. We appreciate it very much. It goes towards me having a baby now, actually, which is kind of scary. Am I streaming later? I actually might be. I was planning on a quiet night, but I've also had a text message saying I'm not going to the gym. So I might actually be streaming later. And maybe Ghost as well. Maybe Ghost as well. If a guild says you can email your application privately, why should you? People ask to do that. Because they're applying secretly. As if you don't want your other guild to know you're applying elsewhere. Perfectly normal. Nothing wrong with that whatsoever. Remember, it's only when you start telling people that you're leaving that you do so. Personally, I prefer to tell people that I'm leaving. If you've got a good reason to leave and it's not because of loot whoring or your guild's still progressing but you want to be further down the line. I don't trust anybody who leaves a guild that is regularly progressing. If you're killing a boss, a new boss, every couple of weeks and you're thinking about leaving, I kind of find that irritating. But if you have a genuinely good reason to leave, like it's ready for you to move on, then you might want to apply privately and you don't want them to be your sponsors. A better way to go about it is that you're leaving, you tell your guild, and you openly request that the raid leader or so on is a sponsor of you. But if you don't want that to happen, that's why you do that. That's why you do that. Okay. All right, guys, I'm going to call it a day there. How do you feel about being a dad? I have no idea yet. I have no idea yet. I really don't know. Oh, sorry. Preach, the Dragonling trinket is high on Ask Mr. Robot, but I don't know if I should count on that. Any comments on that trinket? That trinket is incredibly powerful. Incredibly powerful. One of the best additions to new players is that trinket. It really is. It's so, so good. It just works on so many levels. The fact that you can just choose your own stats makes it really, really powerful. So I'm really happy with that. Thank you very much. Name your kid Bennett. So I'll pay for a I'll pay for college. No, we have names already, but I'm not going to jinx it because, again, it's early in the pregnancy. Anything can happen in the first 3 months. So if I look very sad one day, you know what's happened. All right, guys. Drama Friday is tomorrow. We have got good stories. If you want to send any more that might be better, go ahead and send them and I'll have a read of them. All right. And then we have a workshop on Monday. All right. So I will see you tomorrow at 5 p.m. It's been a long daily. Take it easy. I'll see you again.